Random House Audio presents Mindless Eating, Why We Eat More Than We Think, by Dr. Brian Wansink. Read for you by the author. Everyone, every single one of us, eats how much we eat largely because of what's around us. We overeat not because of hunger, but because of family and friends, packages and plates, names and numbers, labels and lights, colors and candles, shapes and smells, distractions and distances, cupboards and containers. This list is almost as endless as it is invisible. Invisible? Most of us are blissfully unaware of what influences how much we eat. This book focuses on dozens of studies involving thousands of people who, like most of us, believe that how much they eat is mainly determined by how hungry they are, how much they like the food, and what mood they're in. We all think that we're too smart to be tricked by packages, lighting, or plates. We might acknowledge that others could be tricked, but not us. That is what makes mindless eating so dangerous. We are almost never aware that it is happening to us. My lab's research has shown that the average person makes well over 200 decisions about food every day. Breakfast or no breakfast, Pop-Tart or bagel, part of it or all of it, kitchen or car. Every time we pass a candy dish or open up our desk and see a piece of gum or a power bar from 1997, we make a food decision. Yet out of these 200-plus food decisions, most we cannot really explain. But what if we could? If we knew why we ate the way we do, we could eat a little less, eat a little healthier, and enjoy it a lot more. This is why, when it comes to what we eat, lots of people are interested. Getting people to eat healthy foods in the right amounts is of interest to dietitians, calorie counters, and physicians, but also to brand managers, parents, and even governments. It's also of interest to the U.S. Army, Better Homes and Gardens, and to whoever's making your dinner tonight. Since founding the Food and Brand Lab in 1997, I've designed and conducted over 250 studies, written over 100 academic articles, and have made over 200 research presentations to governments and governors, to top universities and companies, to culinary institutes and research institutes, and have presented my research results on every continent but Antarctica. Many of the studies included here have been reported on the front pages of the Wall Street Journal and in the New York Times and USA Today. They've also been reported in the National Enquirer, Annals of Improbable Research, and Uncle John's Bathroom Reader. They've been featured multiple times in 2020, the BBC, and other network TV shows, but they've also been bantered about by Rush Limbaugh and berated by Dr. Laura. I'm on a mindless eating mission. Still, I'm never sure what to say when someone asks me how I became interested in food, psychology, and marketing. I usually say, I really liked Vance Packard's 1957 book, The Hidden Persuaders, because he tried to show how advertising unconsciously influences us. I think the same thing happens when we eat, except the hidden persuaders are the way we set up our tables, our kitchens, and our routines. While that's true, it's not the whole truth. My boyhood summers were spent with my brother and cousins on my uncle and aunt's 138-acre farm near Correctionville, Iowa. The highlight at the end of every summer was the day Aunt Grace and Uncle Lester took us to town to see a movie, followed by a stop at a place I remember as the Dairy Freeze. But in 1968, grain prices were low. When I innocently asked Uncle Lester why we weren't seeing a movie that year, he summarized the state of agricultural economics in 7 words. We would if people ate more corn. To an 8-year-old, this pretty much translated into, if I ever hope to see a movie again, I'd better think of a way to get people to eat more vegetables. Fast forward to 1984. With a newly minted master's degree in communication research, I was working on a consulting project for Better Homes and Gardens. One day, the director of editorial research, the late Ray Deaton, showed me 4 different Better Homes and Gardens cover ideas for an issue that was being published in 10 months. All 4 had the exact same cover photo and looked identical when I first saw them from 4 feet away. When I moved closer, I discovered the only thing that differed, the 6 cover blurbs, or teaser phrases they have on the left side of the cover. Ray asked me to predict which cover would sell the most copies and why. I pointed to one and said, I think this one will do best because it uses shorter little phrases. Without blinking, he said, "Your intuition just cost us over $1 million in newsstand sales." He went on to explain that every month, Better Homes and Gardens took the best ideas for cover stories, developed 4 or more sample covers with a different mix of blurbs, and then asked over 1,000 non-subscribers which version they would be most likely to buy off the newsstand. With a circulation base of over 7.2 million readers, they did not use hunches and intuition. They did research, so they could predict which magazine a blonde, 37-year-old Wisconsin mother of two would pick up, flip through, and buy when standing in the checkout line at Safeway. I was stunned. I was also hooked. Maybe I could learn to predict what foods people would eat, even if they themselves could not. Within 6 months, I had applied to a PhD program in consumer behavior at Stanford, telling them that I wanted to do research on how to get people to eat more vegetables. 6 eye-opening years later, I was a marketing professor at the Tuck School of Business at Dartmouth College with a fuzzy dream of starting a food psychology lab. A lab may conjure up images of test tubes, bubbling beakers, arcing electricity, and researchers with Einstein hair. Sometimes this is close to the truth, even in food research. Consider the physics of French fries. The Argonne National Laboratory helped McDonald's discover how to speed up the time it took to cook French fries. A team headed by physicist Tunker Kaze put sensors inside frozen French fries to best determine how to deal with the steam that was created by melting ice crystals. They then designed special frying baskets that cut 30 to 40 seconds off the frying time for each batch. In contrast, food psychology labs typically study human behavior, and these labs look like mock living rooms, kitchens, or restaurants. Some might even be rigged with one-way mirrors, camouflage cameras, and tables that have hidden scales under the plates. Others might include a row of cramped, 3-feet-wide tasting booths where people can taste test different foods without being distracted. Still others might have small, soundproof rooms for in-depth interviews or larger rooms where groups are brought in to answer psychological surveys related to food. There are dozens of psychology labs that study food, either part-time or full-time. They can be found at great universities in the United States, Britain, Canada, the Netherlands, France, Germany, Finland, and elsewhere. They can also be found in the U.S. Army. Some of the more secretive ones can even be found in food companies. Each of these labs uses different methods to study how we eat. But what all the non-commercial labs have in common is that they aim at publishing their findings in the best academic journals they can. Most of the researchers in these labs hope that what they publish will help make people's lives better. Does it? A lot of it is pretty much ignored. But the 10% that does make a certifiable difference is the reason many of these researchers will never retire, even when they're no longer being paid. I'll be referring most often to 4 labs that have helped shape the questions I see as particularly significant. The University of Illinois Hospitality Management Program. One strength of this program at the University of Illinois in Urbana-Champaign is its research restaurant, the Spice Box. This facility has been used by Jim Painter and myself to study how menus, lighting, music, wine, wait staff, and dining companions influence how much we eat and how much we enjoy the food. It's open only 1 to 2 evenings per week, and it costs less than $25 for an elegant, candlelit white tablecloth meal. This is a win-win-win situation. Diners get great meals, students get great experience, and researchers get great studies. The insights discovered there about menu design, food descriptions, food presentation, and ambiance are coveted by the food industry, including leading restaurant chains. With dozens of people involved in each research project, many of these results accidentally leaked out to company newsletters and planning meetings months before they were officially published in an academic journal. Another lab is the Penn State Department of Nutritional Science. This is the home of Dr. Barbara Roll's lab, where innovative work with food formulations has shown us how variety and caloric density influence how much we eat. If you've read one of the popular weight loss books, the Volumetrics Weight Control Plan or the Volumetrics Eating Plan, you are familiar with some of their work. The lab's food buffet has conclusively proven to the food industry that it can design profitable, lower-calorie food.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.